Hello everyone. Today in biochemistry practical, we shall discuss the topic constituents of normal urine. As per the new CBME guidelines, this is an extremely important topic in biochemistry. The competency number is 11.3. It is a knows how, performs and shows how topic. So you should know all the details about this topic. Let us proceed. So the composition of normal urine has 95% of water, that is 95% is liquid, and 5% is composed of solids. Among the solids, it has both organic and inorganic components. The organic components include non-nitrogen protein substances, and it also includes non-nitrogenous organic substances. Now, what is non-protein nitrogen substance? Non-protein nitrogen substance refers collectively to two nitrogenous constituents of blood such as urea, uric acid, creatinine and ammonia. These compounds are not proteins and yet they have nitrogen, so they are termed as NPN or non-protein nitrogen compounds. These include urea, ammonia, uric acid, creatinine. Now among these four compounds, ammonia is an inorganic compound. Among the other organic substances which are normal constituents of urine are ethyl sulfate and hippuric acid. The inorganic components include both cations and anions. Among the cations, it consists of sodium, potassium, calcium and ammonium ions, whereas the anions include chloride, sulfate, bicarbonate and phosphate ions. So before we proceed with the tests, let us know about the sample collection. Now among the sample collection of urine, there are six types, that is the random specimen collection, for which no specific time is required, and it is the most common way in which a sample of urine is collected. It can be taken at any time of the day and it is used for routine examination of urine. The second kind of sample is known as the early morning sample, which is the first urine sample of the morning, as it is very important because it is the most concentrated urine, and so it is generally used for pregnancy test or microscopic examination of urine. The third type is the clean catch midstream sample, in which the first few ml of the urine are discarded and the remaining volume is collected for analysis. This sample is used for culture testing and culture sensitivity of urine sample. The 24-hour sample is yet another way of collecting urine, in which the entire volume of urine sample for the 24 hours is collected in one container after adding a suitable preservative. And this is used for quantitative and qualitative analysis of various substances found in urine, and it also gives an assessment of renal function of excretion. Now the fifth type is the catheter collection, where urine is collected directly from the catheter in bedridden patients or patients in ICU, and it is sent for microscopy and culture sensitivity testing. So generally it gives a very sterile urine. Now the the suprapubic is a yet another example, but this both catheter collection and suprapubic collection are invasive techniques because we have to take the help of some apparatus to withdraw the urine which is inserted into the body. Now suprapubic aspiration of urine is needed to obtain sterile urine to examine from pediatric patients or patients who are having difficulty in passing out the urine or collecting the urine. Now some of the commonly used preservatives are thymol crystals, concentrated HCl and tartaric acid. There are many other preservatives also. If the urine sample needs longer time to perform the analysis, then it should be refrigerated so that there is no bacterial growth and no change of pH. Now In order to see the composition of normal urine, we must always begin with the physical characteristics and then proceed on to the chemical characteristics. So we will first look at the chemical characteristics of a normal urine sample. Now this is a normal urine sample which has been collected in a beaker. So generally whenever we are doing physical examination of normal urine, these are the six parameters that we check, that is volume, color, odor, appearance, pH and specific gravity. Now just looking at the physical characteristics, a lot can be understood. So the volume of a normal person's urine is lies between 800 to 2500 ml per day. Color of normal urine is generally straw colored. Odor is aromatic odor or ammoniacal odor. Appearance is clear and transparent if it is freshly collected. The pH has a range. It lies between acidic to alkaline, and generally on an average throughout the day it remains acidic, that is 6, and however after meals the urine may turn alkaline due to alkaline tide. The specific gravity again is a very important component of physical characteristics, and it lies between 1.010 to 1.024. So just know, studying these six points given here, that is volume, color, odor, appearance, pH and specific gravity, a lot can be understood about the urine sample of a patient. Now among the physical characteristics of normal urine, volume is extremely important, and we come to know a lot just by examining the volume of the patient's urinary excretion per day. The normal range is 800 to 2500 ml. If the volume is more than 2500 ml per day, it is known as polyuria, and such a volume is seen in conditions like diabetes mellitus and diabetes insipidus. Now if the volume is less than 300 ml per day, it is termed as oliguria, and it is seen in conditions like severe dehydration, acute renal failure, reduced circulatory volume such as fever, edema, and also in loss of fluids like vomiting and diarrhea, which lead to dehydration. Now, if the volume per 24 hours is less than 100 ml per day, it is termed as anuria, and such a low volume excretion is seen in acute tubular necrosis where there is kidney failure, in post blood transfusion reaction, and in post surgical shock also there may be anuria. Now a urine color may be indicative of the hydration of the person. So even in a normal person, though I've stated that the normal urine is straw colored, it may range from clear, almost colorless, to very dark yellow, and this is an indication of the hydration status of the individual. So as the color darkens, the hydration status becomes poor. Now the specific gravity is also a very important parameter. So specific gravity is yet another physical characteristic which is of great importance. Its reference range lies between 1.01 to 1.024. Specific gravity means the amount of solutes in urine per unit volume. Now let us see what is the clinical significance of knowing this physical characteristic, specific gravity. If specific gravity is less than 1.010, that it is known as hypoosmolar condition, which means that there are less number of solutes, and such a situation or condition is seen in diseases like diabetes insipidus or compulsive polydipsia. If it is more than 1.025, then it is a hyperosmolar condition, and it is seen in conditions like diabetes mellitus due to presence of glucose. So here you can see that although there is polyuria in both diabetes insipidus and mellitus, the specific gravity can help us to distinguish between the two. The specific gravity in diabetes insipidus is less than 1.016, it is hypoosmolar, whereas in diabetes mellitus it is hyperosmolar. So this is a very useful parameter in distinguishing between diabetes insipidus and mellitus. Now, hyperosmolar condition is also seen in severe dehydration, nephrotic syndrome due to presence of excessive proteins in urine, and in adrenal insufficiency due to presence of excessive sodium chloride. If specific gravity always remains 1.010 and it is fixed at this level, such a condition is known as isosthenuria, where the specific gravity is fixed no matter what the water intake may be. Such a condition is seen in chronic renal failure, compulsive polydipsia. It may be seen in alcohol ingestion or due to certain drug intake such as diuretics and lithium. Now, the chemical characteristics of normal urine. So here the testing of the normal urine sample is done by various methods. So first we will look at the organic compounds, and in organic compounds first we will see NPN. Now, NPN, as I told you, it is non-protein nitrogen substances. So of these, urea, creatinine and uric acid are organic compounds, whereas ammonia is an inorganic compound. And then we will do the non-nitrogenous substances, which are hippuric acid and ethyl sulfate. And thereafter we shall do tests for inorganic compounds. So let us begin with the chemical characteristics of normal urine. The first compound that we will check is an NPN compound, which is urea. So the test that we will perform is sodium hypobromide test. To carry out this test, you need 2 ml of urine sample in a test tube, to which you have to add 5 drops of 40% sodium hydroxide and 8 to 10 drops of bromine water or sodium hypobromide. Now, after adding all this, the urea will react with sodium hypobromide and a brisk effervescence of nitrogen gas is observed. What exactly is effervescence? These are very small bubbles that are seen in the test tube, and these bubbles are due to production of nitrogen gas. Now you can compare these to visualize with the Sprite. When you pour a Sprite from a bottle into a glass, you see very small bubbles. These are also known as effervescence, and here the effervescence is due to the carbon dioxide gas which is produced. So this way you will get a picture of what is the effervescence due to nitrogen gas. In one condition, the effervescence is due to nitrogen gas, whereas in the other, it is due to carbon dioxide. Now, the production of effervescence says that urea presence is confirmed, and therefore normal urine contains urea. Now, the next test that we will do is the urease test, which is specific for urea. For this test, you take 2 ml of urine sample, and then to it add 1 drop of phenolphthalein reagent and add a pinch of urease powder, which is an enzyme, or you can add urease solution, whichever is present in your lab. After doing so, you will have to leave it for 15 to 20 minutes. Reaction that will occur is urea in presence of urease enzyme will decompose into ammonia. This ammonia is alkaline in nature, so it will react with phenolphthalein to produce a pink color. The production of pink color is indicative of the presence of ammonia, which is released by urea. splitting of urea. So this is a very specific test for urea. The next test is also for urea, and it is known as the biuret test, in which an 5 ml of urea is taken in an evaporating dish and it is heated in the flame till the whole solution is dry and only the solids are left on this. And after this, after it cools down, then we add 1 ml of 10% NaOH and 2 to 3 drops of copper sulfate. So if biuret is formed, then it will form coordinate complex with copper ions and it will turn pinkish or light violet in color. So you know that copper sulfate plus sodium hydroxide in alkaline medium will form coordinate complex with copper cuprous ions and it will give a violet color. Insoluble proteins like keratin and collagen do not give this test. All other proteins give this test, and urea is the only non-protein substance which gives biuret positive. The next compound is the uric acid. Now uric acid is tested by the uric acid reagent test, which is also known as the Caraway's test, in which 2 ml of urine is taken and uric acid reagent is added along with it, 2 to 3 drops of 10% NaOH is added. So here is the uric acid reagent and this is the 10% NaOH. So this reaction also takes place in alkaline medium, and uric acid plus phosphotungstic acid, which is present in uric acid reagent, they give rise to oxides of tungstate, and which is blue in color. So this deep blue color will develop in alkaline medium. Now the next test is the test for creatinine. The name of the test is Jaffe's test. Here 2 ml of urine is taken and then 1 ml of saturated picric acid solution is added. And again we need 10% NaOH. So here also the entire reaction takes place in alkaline pH. So you can notice here that initial few compounds have been tested in alkaline medium, which includes urea, uric acid and creatinine. Now here creatinine plus picric acid will form creatinine picrate in alkaline medium, which is an orange colored complex. So the solution will turn orange color, in orange color. One more NPN compound is ammonia. Although ammonia is an inorganic compound, but it is a non-protein nitrogen compound. Now to detect the presence of ammonia in normal urine, we need 2 ml of urine. To it we can add 3 ml of 10% NaOH and boil the contents and allow the vapors to come out. While the boiling is going on, you have to hold one piece of filter paper which is soaked in phenolphthalein, and as the gas evolves, the ammonia gas will react with phenolphthalein to produce these pink droplets. Now this is exactly how it should look. If your paper becomes like this, the filter paper becomes like this, then it is because of reaction between sodium hydroxide and phenolphthalein, which is not what we want. Now this indicates the presence of ammonia gas. Now the next compound, that organic compound that we will check, is the hippuric acid. What is hippuric acid will be discussed later. Now this hippuric acid is a non-nitrogenous organic compound. So in order to test the presence of hippuric acid, we take 3 ml of neutralized urine and 3 drops of FeCl3. Now here neutralized means first you have to check the pH of urine. If it is acidic, then you have to neutralize it. And then you add 3 drops of ferric chloride to it. So here are the reagents, ferric chloride and 10% NaOH. Then after having neutralized, on adding ferric chloride, the urine sample, if has hippuric acid, it will turn creamish colored. So a creamish colored precipitate is obtained. The next test of non-nitrogen containing organic compound is ethyl sulfate. Again, what is ethyl sulfate will be discussed later. So let us see how the test is performed. We take 3 ml of urine and 3 ml of baryta mixture. So 3 ml of urine with 3 ml of baryta mixture, and to this we add 1 ml of HCl and boil it. So now how exactly we have to see, let us see. First we have to add 3 ml of urine and 3 ml of baryta mixture. We mix it and then filter it. So we filter it, and then whatever precipitates are obtained, they will be on the filter paper, and the filtrate is used for the completion of the test. Now to this filtrate we add 2 drops of concentrated HCl and we boil it. Upon boiling, it will form white precipitates if ethyl sulfate is present, which is a normal constituent of urine, and this is how it will appear. So white precipitates formed, and it will indicate presence of ethyl sulfate. Now we shall carry out tests for inorganic constituents. So inorganic constituents of normal urine include chloride, inorganic sulfate and inorganic phosphate. There are many more compounds and salts and ions that are present in urine, but for you it is enough to test chloride, inorganic sulfate and inorganic phosphate. So we'll start with chloride. Now before I start with chloride, I just want to let you know that the previous tests were all done in presence of in alkaline medium. Starting from ethyl sulfate to chloride, inorganic sulfate and inorganic phosphate, all will be done in acidic medium. And not just mild acidic, we will be using strong acids. So you may be asked, which are the strong acids required for normal urine testing, and which compounds can be tested in presence of strong acids in normal urine. So now let us start with the test for chloride. 2 ml of urine plus 2 ml of concentrated HNO3 plus 1 ml of silver nitrate is added, and it formation of white precipitate due to production of silver chloride indicates the presence of chloride. So here you can see at the bottom there are white precipitates formed. For inorganic sulfate, we need 5 ml of urine, 2 drops of concentrated HCl and 1 ml of barium chloride. Sulfate is precipitated as barium sulfate on reacting with barium chloride, and you can see that white precipitate is formed at the bottom, and it indicates the presence of inorganic sulfate. Now here again I would like to point out that there are 2 types of sulfates in urine. One is the ethyl sulfate, which is organic sulfate, and one is inorganic sulfate, which is present as salts. And the last test is the test for inorganic phosphate. In this we take 2 ml of urine plus 5 drops of concentrated HNO3, then we boil it and add 1 ml of ammonium molybdate solution, and then we heat it. Now after heating, inorganic phosphate is liberated. When the compound containing organic phosphates are heated with NaOH, and this inorganic phosphate reacts with ammonium molybdate to form ammonium phosphomolybdate, which is yellow in color. So yellow precipitate is formed, and you can see here in this test tube. This yellow is also known as canary yellow. So when you are going to conclude, now before concluding, this is how you have to label all your test tubes in the test tube stand, and all of the tests should be kept in a sequence with these label strips for each test, as you can see. And the biuret test, which you do in the porcelain dish, or the evaporating dish, either you can keep it here or you can transfer it to a tube. And here, this is the test for ammonia. This also you have to label and keep it separately for the examiner to view. No reagent should be washed till the examiner has examined you. So after having completed all the tests and making your tables, the last part is the conclusion part. So for normal urine, this is how you conclude that the given sample of normal urine shows the presence of both organic and inorganic compounds. The organic compounds found are the non-protein nitrogen substances, that is urea, uric acid, creatinine and ammonia. The non-nitrogen substances, that is hippuric acid, ethyl sulfate, and the inorganic substances constitute of the following, that is ammonia, chloride, sulfate and phosphate. So this is how you have to conclude. Thank you for watching. Make your notes and complete your journals. Keep reading. Keep enjoying.